Welcome to Sacred Cow Shipyards, where no ship is safe from being taken down to its nuts and bolts. Well, alrighty then. Apparently, in the past week or two, I don't know, there's been a massive influx of all y'all subscriber types or whatever the hell that it is that this particular platform I'm publishing this nonsense on does. So, congratulations, welcome on board, welcome to the shit show, I have no idea what's going on, buckle the fuck up. As you might have probably noticed, there is more than a little profanity involved in this particular show. I do my level best to inform my minions when I swear and when I don't swear, but frequently the minions miss the swearing, so if profanity offends you, I am fucking sorry and fuck off. All those details taken care of. Holy shit, y'all are a goddamn prolific bunch, aren't ya? I mean, seriously, here I am trying to break down this piece of shit YT-3300 freighter that somehow showed up on my god fucking damn dock, and y'all just keep writing these treatises about how this, that, and the other matters. Could y'all argue amongst yourselves for just a brief minute so I could take care of this fucking nightmare? I mean, seriously, if you could buy any ship, don't buy a YT-1300, but that's a different episode. Anywho, continuing on with this, like, administrative bullshit thing that I appear to be doing at the moment, I would like to point out that y'all humies have a nerd streak like a mile fucking long, but this is pushing the envelope. This was sent in to me by apparently one of y'all many new viewers, and apparently someone took my Star Trek's Shuttlecraft Type D episode a little too seriously. And well, that's a minivan. Correct. Good choice, I guess. Oh dear. And now, to round all of this administrative nonsense out, I would like to state for the record that apparently Babylon 5 is being rebooted, resurrected, blah blah blah, so on and so forth, with the specific caveat that the artist involved in all of the original Babylon 5 is basically redoing all of the original Babylon 5. To which I say, not the one. The original Babylon 5 is perfect. Well, might not be perfect, but it is the flaws that give it the value. And no, you don't go back and revisit it. You write something new, you lazy twat muffin. But no, apparently we are entirely redoing the entire Babylon 5 universe from beginning to end, because apparently that's what fucking sells. And I still say no. Write a new story. Spread your creative limbs. Do whatever it is that allowed you to get Babylon 5 to begin with. Because, I mean, seriously, pitching that must have been a nightmare. And you can't even do that now. How far the mighty have fallen. And speaking of reboots, resurrections, blah, 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 so on and so forth, it appears that the Dune books slash movie have been redone yet again. I think this is the third cinematic attempt at them. I'm not sure. I've honestly lost track. But in any case, the movie's already come out in your European continent, I believe, but your United States country unit doesn't have it quite yet. And the real kicker of the movie is that it's only like the first half of the first book, as opposed to tackling the whole book all at once. And maybe the second half hasn't actually been greenlit yet by your Hollywood production company people. So, oh, that'll suck if it doesn't actually go through. Anyways, given this weird timing where the movie's been like half released and it's only half a movie, we're going to spend half the time of this episode talking about the various ships and vehicles and vessels in the original movie. Because I haven't actually seen the new one yet, and I can't really talk about that yet. So, we're not actually going to take a whole episode for each individual vehicle, because we don't actually learn a whole lot about them individually, and I'm not actually going to talk about all of them. I'm actually going to focus on the dropships and the Highliner vehicle, because that thing's just weird. Anyways, here we see the Atreides family-type dropship. Now, it's important to notice that, yes, the families in the Dune universe have their own ship constructors, and they're all built to different patterns. So, the Atreides dropships look very different from the Harkonnen dropships, but they all share this kind of Baroque, Gothic, very ornate styling that we're going to come back to in a little bit. And yeah, you're just going to have to forgive the absolutely horrific graphics. It's an old movie. What are you going to do? Now, that monstrous beast, that thing, that thing's where it gets all kinds of f***ing weird. Because, you see, these little dropships all flying towards it aren't actually FTL-capable in the Dune universe. In fact, FTL-capable ships are very few and far between, mostly because they lose 1 in 10 for every jump. Really bad odds. Also, note the Gothic Baroquishness again. Anyways, these massive ships are basically flying tin cans. All these happy little dropships pile into them with all their people on board and all their equipment and all their cargo and all their stuff. They bolt into the Heighliner, and then the Heighliner folds space. And, well, that's where this all starts getting kind of weird. Because the Heighliner kind of folds space, and the Navigator kind of folds space, and there's all kinds of stuff going on. But anyways, here you can see all of the different dropships all stacked up and ready to go. And again, you can see the ridiculous baroqueness of this aesthetic, this kind of like mishmash of technology and art, and wow! I recently saw something on y'all's interwebs about how maybe Warhammer 40,000 might or might not have been influenced by this Dune movie, or vice versa, and what the shit is that?! Oh right, that flying turd is what happens when you expose a human, one of you humies, to the spice mélange! Which is actually one of your language's words for spice, for way, way, way too long. Yes, that thing used to be a human, and wow, it's shooting energy out of its nose. Anyways, that is the Navigator on board the Heighliner. Basically, ridiculously long-term exposure to ridiculously high quantities of spice grants humans not only mutation, but also prescience. And that's the important part when it comes to FTL travel in the Dune universe, because yes, the Heighliner itself does actually have the Holtzman effect drives, which incidentally, the Holtzman effect also allows Dune to do like shielding technology and stuff like that. And the Holtzman effect drive does allow for instantaneous FTL travel across the entire fucking universe. But the catch is, it is very, 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 very sensitive to gravity wells. If you end up in one when you come out of the Holtzman effect, you're in for a bad time. If you pass through one in between the two points of where you're leaving and where you're going, you're in for a bad time. And that's basically why they lose 1 in 10 of these Heighliner things, along with the millions of people on board and bajillions of whatever currency they're using in the Dune universe of equipment and technology and hardware and stuff. Basically, you didn't really do FTL travel in Dune unless you absolutely had to. Both because it was prohibitively expensive, and because you had a 1 in 10 chance of dying. And to get back to my point about why gravity wells are important for this whole FTL jump thing, these Navigator flying testicle things have the ability to look into the future. They have precognition, so they can hopefully determine whether or not you're going to encounter one of these gravity wells that will reduce you to, well, actually, Frank Herbert never really specified what happened if you missed your jump. So, yeah. All that said and gotten out of the way, given the basic problems with FTL travel in the Dune universe, namely that navigators are so few and far between, and that the rate of loss is ridiculously high, Heighliners make a certain degree of sense. You only have so many navigators, so you can only have so many ships that they can fly pilot. I mean, what else are you going to do? Now, I'm not actually sure that the literal flying tin can motif is such a good design for a massive carrier of smaller ships, but there are other representations of the Heighliner that maybe make a little more sense. Who knows? Anywho, the only other vehicle worth mentioning in the Dune universe at this point in time is the Ornithopter, and I just have to say, what the fuck? Okay, I get it. You want a jet-propelled VTOL or STVTOL or STOL or some sort of short takeoff and or vertical takeoff jet-propelled aircraft, possibly spacecraft, depending on the specific model of the Ornithopter. You can do that so many other ways than this massive contraption of bolted together armatures and moving parts, especially in a dusty, sandy environment. I mean, y'all humies should be well aware of the dangers of helicopters and jets in dusty and sandy environments by this point in your history. But throw in the fact that this thing's wings flap like a bird. I mean, after all, it's an ornithopter. It fucking flaps. And that doesn't actually get you anything aside from a rougher ride and a lot more moving parts. There's just, I mean, it's old
old-fashioned science fiction authors used to just pull cool words out of their asses and integrate them into their stories as a way of just being, like, out of the normal verbiage of the time. And I swear to God, ornithopters are probably that way, too.
And that's all from Sacred Cow Shipyards. Please be advised that any ship left on the dock for more than 24 hours will be compressed to a cube. Have a good day.